Happy New Year, everybody. Oh, is it that bad already? Happy New Year, everyone. Oh, there we go. There we go. We've arrived. And we're still enjoying it, even though it's raining, even though it's January, even though the Christmas decorations seem a little bit tired already. We're pushing in to a new year. And what better way, a special time to come and worship together and to look at God's word this morning together. So very much looking forward to that this morning. Let's pray and ask that God would really speak to us clearly today from his word. We're going to be looking at a passage that's very special to me. I've spent a lot of time with it myself over the past. I feel like God's challenged me around it. And I'm praying that he will do the same for us as a church today. So let's pray. Jesus, we thank you that you love us, that you're for us, that you are excited together with all the heavenly realm that we might even gather to seek you and meet with you today. Holy Spirit, we ask that your presence would be thick in this place today. Lord, we'll encounter you in your word. You ready our hearts to hear you, God. I pray that you'd speak to people even now as we are praying. Be speaking and captivating hearts in this place. In your power, God, bring glory to your name, we pray this morning. Amen. Amen. Well, let's turn to Luke chapter 5. There are Bibles at the end of your rows if you want to, but it's going to be on the screen and I'm going to read it out for us. And it's Jesus calling his first disciples. And many of us may have come across this passage before. You may have heard it along the way at a Sunday school or in school at some point. It's a famous passage and it's profound and challenging for us today. And believe that God wants to speak to us through it. We find Jesus in Capernaum, so he had moved from Nazareth, where he lived, and he had moved to Capernaum and was beginning his ministry. He was beginning to speak to people. People were raising their eyebrows. Who is this Jesus? What's going on? It's quite possible that the people he speaks to in this passage had heard him speak already or had encountered him in some way, but here it gets all the more intimate, all the more personal. So let's read it. One day, as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, and that's the same as the Sea of Galilee, Sea of Tiberias, it's described in different ways, it's the same piece of water. With people crowding around him and listening to the word of God, he saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and he taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into deep water and let down your nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I will let down the nets." When they'd done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord. I am a sinful man." For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will catch men and women." So they pulled their boats up on the shore, left everything, and followed him. A few years ago, I joined a club, a special exclusive club, a club that I quite enjoyed going along to, had coffees and hanging out with friends. I called it the MT Club. That stands for Madame Tussauds. Don't know if any of you have ever been to Madame Tussauds. You can pay and become a member of Madame Tussauds, which is what I did. And the brilliant thing about that is that it's not just the Waxwork Museum, which, you know, is quite interesting. You know, when I first heard about it, I thought, why would I want to go and look at a load of waxwork mannequins? I mean, seriously, I can walk along the high street and look in the shops if I want to see mannequins. I don't need to go to Madame Tussauds, but of course it's all famous. You can have a photo taken with Barack Obama or someone else, or you can, you know, all these famous people, David Beckham and Victoria are all there, so you can go and hang out with them. Of course, it's only waxworks, but, you know, it's almost like the real thing. Not quite, almost. And but the brilliant thing about this card is that it gives you access to Thorpe Park, to Alton Towers, to Warwick Castle, because Madame Tussauds Group own all of these things. So when I used to sort of finish a meeting early, maybe in London, and I was driving home, I used to live just outside London, I'd sometimes be passing Thorpe Park on the M25, and I'd just duck in for a quick roller coaster ride, and then off go back home again. It was brilliant. You know, you didn't have to make the most of your day pass. It was just, you know, in and out any time. And there was one particular time I was meeting a friend at Madame Tussauds, and I came down to Baker Street, and I walked past the long queues, which made me feel very pleased. Long queues of tourists all around the corner waiting to get in, and I just sort of, you know, flashing my card, walking casually down the red carpet. Yeah, I'm a member here. This is my club. You know, so I walked in and kind of got into Madame Tussauds, you know, Johnny Wilkinson kicking the ball, and, you know, all the world leaders all there, and, you know, saw all these things and met my friend in the cafe halfway around Madame Tussauds. Now, after the cafe, we carried on round, and they've got this bit in Madame Tussauds, some of you will know, called the Chamber of Horrors. Dun, dun, dun. Now, the Chamber of Horrors is like full of dastardly people, horrible people who have done terrible things and kind of punishment, torture chamber things. It's not a nice place to be. And you go down the steps after the cafe slowly because it starts getting a bit darker. And then they're pumping out these smells, you know, back street of London. I won't describe that anymore to you. You can probably conjure back street of London smells kind of coming at you, and it's getting darker. And as you go down these steps, you start hearing this kind of high violin, kind of, you know, all of that kind of getting you high with adrenaline. And then it's, and you can hear the heartbeat coming, and your heart starts getting faster, and you step into this dungeon, and it's all dark and horrible, and you can't see anything, and you're already feeling scared. And this particular day, it was a few years ago, I was wearing dark clothes. And so I had a sudden thought, an idea. They didn't used to do this in those days, but they started doing it as a live show at Madame Tussauds now. I'm not advertising them. They've not paid me anything. It's worth going, though. And I was wearing these dark clothes, and I had this idea. I thought, I'll go over to this corner, and I'm going to stand and strike a pose. So my arm is in a piece of light, but I'm in the dark, and I'm going to hold it. So I went over and sort of held this pose. And as I held this pose, some people think I look a bit like Tim Henman. I get that around Wimbledon. You know, people kind of tap me on the shoulder and ask you if I'm Tim or something like that. A little aside, actually, I was playing tennis once, and a little 8-year-old boy waited by the courtside. I was commentating in my game, pretending to be Tim Henman. I think he totally fell for it. And he stood there and he was waiting. And in between swapping games, he came up to me with this bit of paper and asked if I'd give him his autograph, my autograph. So I gave it to him and said, all the best, love, Tim. And and off he went, happy. No, you can't dash his dreams and hopes, can you? Somewhere in Cornwall, there's a little boy who's delighted to have met Tim Henman on his local village court. Seriously, that's a dream. Anyway, sorry if you're watching and it's ruined everything. Okay, so there's Tim Henman standing absolutely still in the Chamber of Horrors. Not that I think he would be there, but, you know, here he is. And I was holding this pose, and as I held the pose, a group of American tourists came round the corner, led by a sort of a lady with an umbrella, kind of being a bit like, this way, you know, come on, everyone. Don't you love any Americans in the house today? Yeah, oh, so a few. I love you guys. You're so up for everything. You're all like, this is so good. Everything's so brilliant. It's like, come on, this is an amazing experience. We love Madame Tussauds. It's brilliant. Sorry about the accent. And I'm standing there and around this, oh, look at this one over here. And I'm like, oh. And I suddenly thought, okay, I've got a decision. Either I walk away now and no one's embarrassed, or I hold this and try and pull it off. So in the midst of that decision, she's already heading for me, and she's reaching out her hand, exclaiming to everyone, this one's got real stubble. And I'm like, oh, she's gonna stroke me. So I'm standing there, and you know when someone looks at you, eyeballing you and about to stroke you, you know when that happens, yeah? And you can't not smile, can you? So I'm holding my angry Tim Henman face as hard as I can. I held it absolutely still as far as I could. And I jumped out at her, and she was like, oh my goodness, oh, it's scary. And all the Americans went flying everywhere, and I was like, oh no. They were all over the place, and so I stayed for half an hour and scared people ongoing in the dungeon. It was just brilliant. I loved it. It was really fun. Now, I love that story because thinking about it afterwards, it suddenly become a real story of my faith. And you're thinking, sorry? It's not that my faith means jumping out at American tourists or passing the queues or anything like that. But as I thought about it, and this is where it comes to this passage, this Luke 5. You see, when Jesus called Simon Peter to follow him, he didn't want Simon Peter to be inactive, to be passive in his following. He wanted him to be active and alive. Now, going around Madame Tussauds, it's wonderful, but they're just waxwork imitations. They're not the real thing. They're a shadow of the real thing. They kind of look like the real thing, but they're not quite the real thing. They're imitations, static. And though they can be looked at and everyone goes, wow, they're not impacting or influencing the environment around them. And when Jesus called those first disciples, he had in mind, I want you to come and follow me so that you can be active and you can impact the world around you. Just as I jumped out at those tourists and everything changed, there was transformation in the dungeon that moment because I was active suddenly. I wasn't just some shadow of what I was meant to be. I wasn't just almost an imitation of what I was made to be. I was living, I was alive, I was active, and I was influencing the surroundings that I was in. You see, when Jesus called these disciples, he wanted them to be active. When he called them to follow him, he was actually calling them to lead. And that's what Jesus says to us today. You see, if you choose to follow Jesus, what does he say? Follow me, and I will teach you to be fishers of men and women. I will teach you to do the stuff I do. I want to show you what I can do, and I want to teach you how to do that stuff. If you want to follow me, Jesus says, it's not just some passive following. It's an active, engaged faith that is going to multiply and transform the lives of others. And so, let's delve into this passage. Let's learn a few things. Let's make a few observations from this passage as we seek to understand how we can become that too, how we can follow in order to lead. So the first thing is this. In verse 4, we get this. Jesus asks Simon Peter to go deep and to be expectant. Let me read the verse. Jesus asked Simon Peter to go deep and be expectant. When he'd finished speaking, Jesus, he said to Simon, put out into deep water and let down the nets for a catch. Jesus asked Simon Peter, go deep, be expectant. Now, it's interesting that he asked Simon Peter to go out into the deep water. It's not something they would have done at that time. We find out from that passage, those disciples, they were fishing at nighttime. And they had come and they'd left their boats. They were washing their nets. It was the morning time and Jesus was speaking to crowds. And the reason they fished at night, firstly, because the fish came to the surface, they were easier to catch. Secondly, it was a safer time of day to go fishing on what was quite a perilous lake. You see, if you visit that area, and some of you may have visited the area, and right where Capernaum is, it's on the north shores of the Sea of Galilee. And the Sea of Galilee stretches. It's not a huge piece of water. You can see from one side to the other. It's not huge, and it stretches down this valley. And the winds come down the valley, particularly in daytime, as the heat rises, the winds rush down the valley, and they whip up the water so that storms are created in that piece of sea, in that lake. And we know that from other biblical passages where Jesus is caught in a storm or the disciples trying to cross the river and Jesus walking on the water. They're all stormy situations. And so this bit of water was used to being stormy. So to go deep in the daytime was to take a risk. Jesus was asking Simon Peter to take a risk. Go deep, take a risk. Do something maybe you've not done before. And more than that, he asked Simon Peter to be expectant. It wasn't just go out there and hang out. It was go out and put down the nets for a catch. You know, you wouldn't put out fishing nets that you've just washed. You've just cleaned them off from the night's work, and now you're going to put them out again unless you're expecting to catch fish. And Jesus was saying to Simon Peter, I want you to go out there, go be deep with me, and be expectant for a catch. Not just a line, but a net. We're expectant. Now, what does that mean for us? I wonder what it means for you to go deep this new year. As you start January 2015, what does it look like for you to go deep? Perhaps to take a risk. Perhaps to try something you've not tried before. Perhaps to respond to Jesus' call over your life in a way that you've not responded before. A fresh commitment to pursuing him, to going deeper, to saying, God, I want to go where you want me to go. I want to go deep. Maybe that's a risk. Maybe that's a conversation or a different way of being at work. Maybe it's something in your family and saying, actually, I want to go deep into that. I know it's a bit risky. I know it could be difficult, but I want to go there with you, Jesus. I believe you're speaking to me about that. What does it look like for you to go deep? And what does it look like for you to be expectant? How can you grow that expectancy in your life this year? You know, if we're not expectant, if we don't expect anything, then we're often not looking forward to something, are we? We're not expecting, we're not looking forward to it. And yet we all know from Christmas, many of us look forward to Christmas, and there's an expectancy and we can't wait and it's fun and, you know, Father Christmas is coming and all of that stuff. It's an expectancy that builds to make it a special day. What are you expectant for? See, I don't think expectancy is just an emotion that comes upon us. There are moments when suddenly we feel expectant because everyone's feeling expectant, or we can't wait, or somebody's coming around the corner, and it's almost an emotion that comes upon us. But actually, expectancy is something that we can grow within us as well. We can grow that expectancy in us. Here's perhaps a New Year's resolution for you. How about praying every day and saying, God, what are you expectant for today? Amen. A simple prayer on a daily basis, and begin listening and begin growing that expectancy. What is it that God's expectant for today? Because I know that he's an expectant God. He has great plans for each of us personally, for us as a church, for this city, for the world. And he's expectant for those things to arrive. And he wants us to be a part of that. He wants us to grow to be a church that is part of that expectancy, that coming kingdom that is breaking in day after day. What are you expectant for? Next observation. Let's skip to verse 5. So he's asked Simon Peter to go deep and to be expectant. And now, a real challenge. He asks Simon Peter to push in for obedience over disappointment. To go for obedience over disappointment. Listen to this. Simon answered, Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I'll let down the nets. You see, they've been out all night. They've had the disappointment of a whole night's fishing and catching nothing. That's kind of embarrassing for a fisherman, isn't it? You know, this is my job and it's not gone right. And here you are, this special person teaching all these people, and you're exposing the fact that we've not caught anything in our own merit. I kind of imagine there was a pregnant pause in that sentence. You know, that Simon Peter goes, Master, we've been out all night and we haven't caught anything. Pregnant pause. And there's Peter in his mind thinking, okay, Jesus, this is where you step in and say, oh, Simon Peter, you're the fisherman. You know what you're doing. And, you know, if you've not caught anything, maybe this is a silly idea after all. Let's not bother. You've just cleaned the nets. There's no hassle here. And then in Jesus' mind, in the pregnant pause, it's like, Simon Peter, I created this lake. I formed the fish that swim therein. I know all things. And though you carry disappointment from things working out not quite as you hoped, I have more for you. I have more for you. Pause over. And Simon Peter says, but because you say so, I will let down the nets. What an amazing thing to say. You see, Peter chooses obedience over disappointment. He chooses, because Jesus is saying, let's go and do this thing. Let's go and change the world. Let's go and catch these fish here in this instance. That Peter is then, it's been hard, but because you say so, I'm going to do it. He chooses obedience. You know, disappointment can absolutely disarm us. But obedience leads to overflow. Disappointment can absolutely disarm us, but obedience leads to overflow. And Peter throws out the nets and all these fish come in. In fact, it's such an incredible catch of fish. It's not just net breaking, it's boat sinking. This is a catch of fish like never seen before. These are fishermen who watch the lake day in, day out, and they are astounded by what happens. This Jesus, able to do something extraordinary beyond their understanding, even off the back of their disappointment. And what makes this miracle even more amazing is that they hadn't caught anything in the nighttime. Do you see? If they'd gone out at nighttime and they'd caught loads of fish and there was nets and they were hauling all these fish onto the shore and, you know, there were just fish everywhere. This lake is teeming. This fish, you know, it's, oh, everything's, you know, we managed to do this as fishermen on our own. And then Jesus said, let's go and get some more. And they got some more. It wouldn't have seemed quite so incredible, would it? And so there's this interesting dynamic here that even where there's been this disappointment, God can break in and bring something that we know is only from him, not from our own excellence. And sometimes when we find ourselves in a difficult or a dark place, if we are able to not allow that disappointment to disarm us, but choose obedience over disappointment, then God can and will bring overflow. He can and he will bring overflow. Final thing, just to pull out. If we skip to verse 8 and 9, Jesus has called Simon Peter to go deep and be expectant. He's called Simon Peter to go for obedience over disappointment. And then we find Simon Peter's response. When Simon Peter saw this, verse 8, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord, I'm a sinful man." For he and all his companions were astounded at the catch of fish that they had taken. You see, when this thing happened, it was so extravagant. A picture of what Jesus was beginning to call them into, that he was going to call them to follow him so that they too might become fishers of men and women. And he wasn't showing them a picture of, here's one fish, catch it. He was showing them this extravagant catch of fish, unlike anything they'd ever seen before. He was stretching their expectation. He was calling them into the depth. And as they responded in obedience, Jesus inspires transformation in them. You see, Simon Peter falls to his knees and is like, Lord, who am I to be anywhere near you? He catches something of who Jesus is. Like, why would you choose me? I'm sinful. Don't you know that, God? Don't you know that I'm not perfect? Don't you know that I'm just here doing my job day in, day out? You are something totally other than Jesus, and I don't deserve to be anywhere near you. We feel like that sometimes, don't we? How could this God use me? How can he partner? Doesn't he know I'm sinful? But true to character, Jesus stands before him and says, essentially, don't let that sin disable you from coming with me. I'm choosing you. I'm calling you to follow me. I want you to put in everything, and I can use whatever you give. It's like the grace and the love of God flowed at that moment in the boat as it struggled with the fish flapping everywhere. And there's Jesus saying, no, Simon, no, Simon, that's the point. You think you can't do it? You know you couldn't do it last night, but with me, we're going for this adventure, and I'm going to teach you what it looks like to fish for men and women. You're not going to just fish for these fish anymore. You're going to change the world around you, Simon Peter. So who were these disciples that Jesus was calling? Let's remind ourselves. We know it's just these fishermen, don't we? We've heard that over these last few minutes. But we need to be reminded of that this morning, right here, right now. You see, Jesus didn't go to the Oxford and the Cambridge to find the brightest and the best and choose the elite ones to come and be his followers so that, you know, he had the brightest and the best, so they were the wonderful ones who, you know, everyone would look at and go, wow, Jesus is brilliant. He intentionally went after normal people like you and like me. He intentionally went for it, and he was radical in who he chose to follow him. He released people like never before. He had this expectation that people, as they chose to follow him, would emulate what he did and impact the world around them. And so he empowered the women around him. He empowered the men around him. Many of those disciples, when they were called, would have been in their teenage years. When a rabbi started out at 30 years old, which is what Jesus was at this moment, they would choose some disciples, people to follow. And those disciples would be anything under 30. And most rabbis would choose the brightest and the best. Most rabbis would go and get the educated ones. Most rabbis would choose the ones that everyone expected them to choose. Not Jesus. He chose a bunch of normal people, some of them misfits. They'd known their failures. And he chose them and said, you lot, some of them teenagers, you lot, I want to trust you with the things of the kingdom. I want you to follow me. And so he empowers all of us. There's not a person sitting in this church today who is not empowered by the call of Jesus to follow him and become a fisher of men and women. Not one of us. It's a call that Jesus gave on that day, and it's a call that he gives this day to us here in this place. It's an invitation that rolls on and on and on today and into this year. And the passage finishes with this verse, that they pulled up their boats on the shore. They left everything and followed him. Can't believe that, can you? We can't believe that, because what a radical call to leave everything and to really go for this. What a radical call to really press into Jesus, so much so that I would leave everything for the sake of his call on my life. But of course they did. Of course they responded like that. They'd seen the King of Kings doing this remarkable miracle in front of their eyes. They had encountered God. Of course they did. They left everything and followed him. And so the question this passage begs us this morning, at the beginning of 2015, is, will we have a fresh commitment to following him with everything, into everything? Will we go deep? Be expectant? Will we choose obedience over disappointment again and again? And will we step up and step in to the call that Jesus has over each and every one of us? Because the Jesus who walked on the shores of Capernaum all those years ago is as alive and well today and calls us as his church to do the same. And who knows, if we as a community, as a church, actually responded to this and said, okay, I'm all in. I don't want to be this plastic imitation, this waxwork anymore. I don't want to be a shadow of what I was made to be, but I want to step in and be active. I want to influence those around me. I want to follow Jesus in order to lead others. I want to declare stuff over this city. I want to invite people into Alpha, into church, invite people to come and know him, this great shepherd. I want to be the fisherman he called me to be and to bring others into the kingdom so that this year we see the church alive and active with everyone playing their part, released into God's purposes for you. And that this year we see more people come to know Jesus than we've ever seen in a year before. But that would take all of us. That would take each of us. And will you follow him in order to lead?